conversation and let's talk about the direction of the college, especially in the area that you're dealing with. And, you know, a really good way to start, let's start at 30,000 feet. Okay. And let's talk a little bit about a university model and compare and contrast that with a community college model. And this is in the realm of COVID.
Okay.
So talk a little bit about what the universities sure. are doing, and you and I are connected with our seven colleague sister institutions, and I hear what the presidents are saying, right. and you hear what the provosts are saying. Right. So talk a little bit about the difference between the four community colleges and the four-year institutions. Okay.
So I'll just start with the universities. And I would say, I say this with all seriousness, that there is almost a sense of panic amongst the four-year colleges and universities in Idaho. They have so many extra facilities, extra activities that they have to contend with, such as football teams, sororities, fraternities, field hockey teams, and as Rick likes to say, Rick always talks about a rodeo team, and you know, I'm beginning to wonder if Rick really wants a rodeo team. He mentions it all the time, so I'm beginning to think that deep down, he hopes one day, perhaps CEI will have a rodeo team. Anyway, for now, we don't, and that's a very good thing. Because the universities have so much more to deal with, the dorms, how they send people home, how they, just the idea of the refunds they're going to have to do, they're talking about that in depth, the amount of money that they're going to have to cut from their budgets is enormous, and so they have all of those extra things that they have to contend with that we as community colleges don't, and so the four community colleges in Idaho, the other three community colleges, again, because they've been established for many of them for 50 years, CWI certainly hasn't been that long, but all of them have a much longer track record, and they've gotten a whole lot more infrastructure that they have to deal with as we begin to think about how we're going to contend with COVID. And so as I talk with my other seven counterparts across the state, what I hear is, they feel very concerned, if not desperate. They feel that there is so much that they're going to have to cut from their budgets. Just keep going. Okay. Oops, yeah, okay. All right. I'm sorry. Okay. So they feel like that there's so much that they have to do cut. And as I speak with them, and I'm talking with my counterparts very, very often, it really is all doom and gloom for them. There's not a whole lot of positivity, and I'm not saying that COVID is positive. COVID has been horrible. It has turned all of our worlds upside down. But I can tell you, as I talk over and over again with my counterparts, where CEI is positioned is in an amazing place. The fact that we don't have all of those extras that we have to contend with, we don't have dorms, we don't have sororities, we don't have football teams, it allows us to be very forward thinking, because we're not thinking of how we have to deal with all of this infrastructure that's going to have to be rethought, retooled. Right. We can begin to be very forward thinking on how we're going to deal with this and how we're going to come out of it.
So you would say, you know, a month ago, we would say that we had a deficit because we didn't have swimming pools and
that's right.
International students, Mike. We don't have international students. And we don't have football teams and those kind of things. But now in this COVID world, we go, we are so fortunate. Yeah. We can pivot instantly, and we did. And again, talk for just a little bit, for a moment, about both student services and instruction and how we moved the block of face-to-face instruction over to our students and how that worked.
Sure. So we did it very quickly. We did it in about a week. We had already started going to a red-blue team. Having half of our people on campus and half of our people off of campus. So we had a little bit of notice that this was coming, but I will tell you that when the governor made that announcement that he was implementing a stay-at-home order, it kind of caught everybody off guard because I don't think they expected on that Wednesday. I remember the Wednesday we were doing gen ed interviews, and that nobody expected that Wednesday at that press conference that that's what the governor was going to say. And when he did it, luckily, we had just a little bit of a head start on that, and that was right before spring break. And so we ended up going to spring break early. Our faculty, our students got about 3 extra days of spring break. And our faculty very quickly beginning working with their deans, department chairs, and then across all of the faculty departments from CTE to Gen Ed, just really scaled up quickly working with Ryan and Jenny and their departments, kind of an all hands on deck team effort to make sure that we could have all of those classes ready to go on Monday when students came back from spring break. So that was about a 10-day lead-in to be able to do this. And so we did it, and we had like brown bag lunches with Ryan and his group, helping faculty to understand some of the tools that they could use. We began getting, some people needed whiteboards at home. We got whiteboards at home so they could do Zoom classes by Zoom. In particular in the math, I can see Betsy with her whiteboard behind with her formulas on there, which is amazing. I mean, so it was really, what can we do to be able to deliver the curriculum? We were very fortunate that Northwest said, okay, seat time is out the window. You can just teach to those outcomes. And so we've had some classes that have been able to finish early. Some classes are still going. We're just making sure that we meet those outcomes. And then beyond that, student affairs very quickly pivoted as well. And Mike had his team really positioned well to be able to do this quickly. And so all of a sudden, almost overnight, we were able to do advising online, admissions online, counseling online. Center for New Directions were able to do some of their things online. I'm probably missing some of those things that we were able to very quickly move to online. But we were able really to take that student, a student who was used to coming on campus every single day or 3 times a week, and really quickly put them into the virtual environment and right. offer most of those services that they needed. So again, I want to say that this was such a huge collaborative team effort. And nobody was upset or complaining. Everybody thought, okay, how are we going to serve that student? And how are we going right. to get that student through? And I will tell you, we extended that drop date to April 30th. And on April 30th, according to Raylan and Mike, we really had negligible amount of students who dropped. And that is just a testament, again, to everybody across campus and all the work that was put in to get
the drop date was April 17th, not the 30th, just to clarify. Sorry to interrupt.
Oh, no, that's right. Thank you, Mike. I got confused with dual credit drop date. So April 17th. So anyway, but on April 17th, we had very few students who dropped. And again, that's a testament to everything that all of you guys did to make sure that the students were able to stay and get through and finish their semester.
And last week, I got a chance to show some of the student feedback forms. And again, they were very positive.
Were.
These are students who have computers, but for the ones that had computers, it was very positive. So talk for a second. Traditionally for us, a community college does Associate of Arts, Associate of Science. We do Associate of Applied Science, AASs. But in a time of retooling, in a time of massive unemployment, the community colleges have a unique role that the universities don't. So kind of tee that up for everyone watching what okay. we're going to be looking for here at the college.
Okay. So what's interesting is that College of Eastern Idaho, even in an economy where unemployment was very, very low, we were still growing. We were still adding students to our numbers. But primarily when you have unemployment that goes up, then higher education in general, not just community colleges, right. tend to see an increase in enrollment. But in a situation like this where we have had so many people lose their jobs, especially the people who were working in low-paying jobs, jobs that didn't have benefits, jobs that didn't have retirement, vacation, things like that, the community colleges working with the Department of Labor are usually the go-to to get that workforce retrained and back out into better jobs, hopefully, than they had before. So I think we're even in a more unique position where we sit right now, sitting next to the INL. So most of you have heard that the INL probably has about 5,000 jobs coming in the next 6 to 10 years. And many of those jobs are going to be jobs where the training that they're going to need to do them fall right in our community college realm. So we're not talking obviously about the bachelor's and the masters and PhDs. There will be some of those jobs that will be coming. There will also be some jobs that are coming that are that you don't need any training for.
Right.
But many of those jobs are going to be technician style jobs that we can provide. And so the idea that while it's horrific that so many people have lost their jobs, a lot of those jobs, again, are in those low-paying sector jobs. And so if we can get those students, get them into our doors, get them into programs that the INL, Malalucas, some of the other big employers are looking for, then actually at the end, at the end when we come out on the other side, we will have a group of students who are better trained, they have gotten better paying jobs, and then hopefully they're with corp companies that if they want to go on and get more training, the company then pays for it. So it could turn out that this is a good thing in the long run, while initially it's an awful thing. We're hoping to really help those students in our community.
So we have a unique mission that's unlike the universities. And given this strange circumstance, we are unique, and probably the four of us community colleges are best positioned to get Idahoans back to work.
That is correct. We are going to be the ones who turn this economy around and get people back to work, again, in really good paying jobs, especially here in southeastern Idaho. So the other community colleges will be doing the same thing, but College of Eastern Idaho positioned next to INL and specifically positioned where all of these new jobs are coming with the small modular reactors, the micro reactors, the virtual test reactor. These are all initiatives that are going to need technician-trained people to work many of the jobs that are coming. So we're very fortunate to be in the position we're in, even amidst this COVID crisis.
So communication with the bulk of our faculty and staff, employees working from home, becomes tricky. So talk a little bit about, as a vice president, how are you communicating with faculty, staff, and students when we're socially distanced like this?
Yeah.
What are the techniques you've used? What have you found to be successful, and where do you think some gaps might be?
Yeah. So the short answer to that is I've been communicating a lot, as all of you know, getting lots of emails from me. And I know that some of my emails are getting forwarded. So the first thing I've done is every morning since the governor announced on Wednesday,
right,
that on a Wednesday that we were going to be at a stay-at-home order, and it was effective immediately. So starting that Thursday morning, I started sending a morning email to my vice president council. And it was an email that was really nothing about COVID or anything like that. It was meant to be an email to be encouragement. And sometimes it was encouraging and sometimes they were long. And anyway, and there was always a quote of the day and a good thing of the day. And I know some people have been forwarding those on as well. So there has been that kind of communication. And then there has been a lot of Zoom meetings, a lot of Teams meetings. But what I would say is what I have seen overall is that the communication and the collaboration has actually expanded from what it was prior to COVID. And I think,
right,
part of that is that everybody just needs to know, what is it you're doing in your classes to make a better discussion board, or to get in touch with students, or to get students to respond. And student affairs, I know that they've been having their all student affairs meetings at least once a week. That was something that they were just doing once a month.
Talk about the parking lot meetings.
Oh, right. And so there have been several parking lot meetings where people have said, we miss our workmates, so let's just all get in our cars and come meet in the parking lot and have lunch, or have a meeting in the parking lot so we can actually see each other face to face. So that's something that obviously hadn't been happening before.
We've never done it. That's a thing now that never existed a month ago.
A parking lot meeting is something that we do regularly. And so it's just, I think that there has been more communication, more collaboration, more cross campus pollination, for lack of a better word, of people just wanting to know what's going on. And part of that is just wanting that connection, because being at home can feel quite isolating sometimes. And so the fact that everybody is reaching out and learning how to do Zoom and learning how to do Teams. I had no idea how to do Teams. And Mike Walker was like, Lori, even you can do Teams. I'll teach you how to do it. And I think in 5 minutes, he taught me how to do it. And now I use it. And some of you wish I didn't know how to use it, because I just call you because I can, because I know how to use the technology. Anyway, Mike's shaking his head. He's like, yes, it's true. So anyway, because we're all learning a lot of the different ways to communicate. And the other day I was with somebody, and I think I was in a Zoom meeting, and somebody was Teams calling me, and somebody was texting me, and somebody was Facebook messaging me. And it was like, oh man, there are so many ways to communicate now. And so with all of those communication methods, again, on purpose, and sometimes just calling to say, hey, how are you doing? The communication is really great. And I will tell you, Rick, that what I have heard from a lot of people is there is great appreciation coming from your office, all of the communication that's been happening.
Well, good.
It helps everybody know what's going on. I think people feel like they understand what the process is, where we're at, what's happening next, as best as we can figure it out with the information we have.
Good, absolutely. Hey, may I point out that we're at 128 viewers now.
Oh, do you know what I'm going to say?
Well, I don't know. What are you going to say?
I'm going to say that's more than was on yours.
No, I saw 133.
Oh, I thought.
Thanks for bringing.
Oh, I thought it was. Come on, people, get other people on.
This
is going to be Rick.
Telethon. You've got to get over 133, or Lori won't live this down.
I won't. Come on, people. It's all a comp. Sign in on a different device if you have to.
Okay.
Anyway.
So, you know, talk about what we've done with students. So from a student affairs perspective, we have a lot of employees at home, but they have been very productive. Talk about that.
So our employees from student affairs and even beyond, we have some people outside of student affairs who are also participating in this. So something that Mike and I decided that we should do is that we should contact every single student who's going to college here. And so I just had an update from Mike this morning, and already more than 1,000 students have been called. Now, that is a lot of students. And I mean, that is a lot of work. That's a lot of students. We have a script pretty much that we're asking our employees to read. And the overwhelming feedback has been amazing. Students are so glad to hear from us. They are so glad to hear that we care. They are saying, you know, we feel so isolated, but it's so nice to hear from you. So this has been a huge undertaking, but something that is so important, because what we know is that personal touch is what helps students stay. It helps keep them in college. It helps get them to their degree and credential. So that personal touch, and we can still do that here. We're still small enough that we can make that happen. And we want every student to feel like they are a student and not a number. And being able to call like this is one of the ways to do it. So Haley has started a few activities for students to be able to do virtually. Effie Hernandez has started something called CEI Connect. She had her first activity with that last week. That was a huge success, or maybe it was earlier this week. It was a huge success. That's just where she's bringing in high school counselors, and then they're inviting what students might be interested in coming here, answering questions or concerns they might have. So we're super excited about all the outreach we've been able to do virtually.
You know, I see Jodine on this.
Okay. Yes.
Well, I'm sorry.
I get so excited.
I know you do.
Jodine. I was so excited. I think when Clint first told me about what you were planning on doing, he's like, okay, Lori, you're way more excited than me, and you just need to calm down. So, and Rick highlighted this in his update last Sunday, but they are going to do a nurse pin at the drive-in. So at a drive-in, is it in Rexburg, Jodine?
It is. I see that they figured out a way to get a hold of some of the ones in Idle Falls, but we could not figure out how to get a hold of them at the time. So it is in Rexburg.
Yeah. So we are going to have the nurse pinning. That's always such a seminal event for every semester for our nurses. It's a wonderful event. You usually, I think that, I don't know that anybody leaves with a dry eye from the
pinnings.
They're just fabulous.
They're wonderful.
And the idea of not doing it this year, just our nursing staff just said that's not acceptable. So they found a way to do it. So at the drive-in in Rexburg, the nurses are going to drive their cars up there. We're going to pre-record some of the student speeches. I don't know if we're pre-recording some of Jodine and Kathleen's speeches. And then the nurses will drive up and they'll get their pin. And then I believe that they're going there as they drive up and drive by, that their image will be projected on the screen. So I'm really thinking of innovative ways in order to honor our students, since we can't have graduation. Rick, you keep looking at the clock. Am I talking?
No, this is a horrible shock because I thought we were going to have dead air at the very end of 45 minutes, but we have like 20 minutes left and we're at question two.
Oh boy. So. Well, I sent Rick a list, and I walked into his office and I said, "Did you get my list?" And he just started laughing. So, because it was so long. But I don't want dead air.
No, we don't. No, dead air is a killer on these things. So,
that's right.
So you've covered a lot of these things, but let's take a look at the instructional and student affairs strategy and talk a little bit about spring, summer, and fall. So what are you planning? I think you've covered a number of these for spring, the current semester. Maybe talk about the testing center, which is one that I don't think you brought up yet, but let's go through your strategy, because the most important thing we can do is to get students into the College of Eastern Idaho. That is so critical.
Right. So right now, that really is our number one concern, is enrollment. We need enrollments. We need students to come and choose College of Eastern Idaho. And we think we have a good chance of our enrollments going up both in summer and spring, because many students who might have gone back, who might have been going to Boise State University, Montana State University, maybe they're not going to go. And so we want to capture them and have them come here. So spring strategy right now is to just get through. And we are doing it really in a spectacular way, not an easy way. I know I just talked with a couple of students and an instructor this morning, and it's hard. It's been really, really hard. But the fact is that through that difficulty, we're managing to move through and get our students to the end, and with very few drops and very few incompletes. So that's very exciting. For summer, our strategy is, as all of you know, we've chosen to move all of our classes online for summer. And Angela is really busy. Angela and the department chairs are busy on figuring out ways to deliver that curriculum in the best way. Jenny and Ryan are a huge part of that. Jenny has created a checklist that is going to be so helpful for all of the instructors, especially for new instructors who are teaching online for the first time. We're really excited about that. We're very excited about the collaborative nature that's going on between the online department and the Gen Ed faculty. So right now it's thinking about moving from, you know, we had to move those classes very quickly, and it was just kind of a mad dash to really throw a lot of classes online. So summer, we're thinking more methodically. How can we make sure that those classes are quality, they're meeting a standard, and that the academics are being delivered in a really great way? And then for summer also, we're thinking, how can we upscale the wraparound services for student affairs? So even though we're doing it right now, how can we do it in a more methodical way of making sure that the students are getting, again, in a methodical way, getting their advising, getting their admissions, advising, counseling, testing, all of those things online. So we've recently signed on with Proctorio, and so we can do remote testing with through the testing center. Larry has just done an amazing job. He's recently gotten a national certification that will make testing, our testing, be able to be used for admissions for other colleges. So we're right there in getting everything that we need to be able to really think about going from just being online to being a virtual campus. And what I would say is that we're using summer kind of as a proof of concept for what needs to change, what we need to alter and tweak right. in order to have a really top-notch virtual campus and online delivery for fall.
So speaking of fall, talk a little bit about, partly your job is to see into the future and predict the future. So as a vice president, you have to be able to look in the future and predict things. So what are you predicting for fall, and how are you setting up classes, and how are you working with student services? And we all agree it's a kind of a tricky job because so much is unknown, but what are you seeing for fall? We kind of know what's going to happen in summer. We know that this is going to be online, but what about fall?
So doing my best to read the tea leaves, see what they might say for fall. So I think fall is a bit of a wild card. So what I really see in a shorter answer, and then I can expand on it, in a shorter answer is that I see we still have face-to-face classes in Gen Ed and certainly in CTE. Certainly all of those, the trades labs, maybe some science labs that we will have face-to-face. And quite a few just of your general Gen Ed classes face-to-face as well. So I see that, but I see an uptick and a scaling up of offering those online classes as well. So we'll be offering more online classes than what we thought we might be offering 2 months ago, 2.5 months ago. So part of that is just taking many of those that have already been moved to the online space and kind of making sure that they're meeting certain standards, they're meeting the quality that they need to. And so that's what I see for academics. And so for student affairs, what I see is, again, just a scaling up of the online offering, the virtual advising, virtual online testing, virtual admissions, counseling, what's offered through Center for New Directions, online, being able to do everything financial that you need to do with financial aid online. So again, thinking about just going from offering online classes to it actually being a virtual campus. So a student could actually do everything that they would do on campus, they would be able to do that in the online space. And that's what I really see. I don't see right now with the information we have right now, certainly with the governor's orders that came out yesterday, I don't see us having to have all of our classes online. The only reason I can see that would happen is if, as everything begins to open up, that we start seeing a second wave of infection. And I think the governor has a really good plan to try to make sure that doesn't happen. So I guess that there still is a possibility that we could say all classes in fall would be online, but that's only if we start seeing an uptick in those infections right. and the governor says, okay, we've got to shut everything down again. But even irrespective of what the governor says, I do see us having a lot more online offerings than we thought we would 2 months ago.
So do you think we're going to be wearing masks in fall?
I do.
Okay.
I think that the governor, I think that masks, and thinking about what Troy, we've said in several talks with Troy Brunfeld, who is the chief medical officer for Community Care Mountain View Hospital.
Right.
And he believes that we now live in a mask world, so that we're going to all be wearing masks for a long time. And so I do think, especially as we start bringing more and more people back on campus, that masks are going to be a part of our reality.
That is probably true. So maybe touch a little bit more on trades. So one of the things that we can't do virtually would be the welding, the auto, the diesel, certainly elements of nursing. So,
right.
So kind of reflect on that, what you think we should be thinking about in fall.
Right. So those trades labs, they will be open. Again, unless the governor just tells us you absolutely can't do that. And really, he hasn't told us that now.
No.
So we've had a lot of leeway and freedom under this stay home order, and we've just started bringing the trades, welding, diesel, Those people who needed lab time, we started bringing them back again under very strict protocol, no more than 10, masks, lots of disinfection, lots of sanitation, getting them so they can get through without us having to offer too many incompletes. So in the fall, that's what I see, you know, that the trades labs will be open, and some of the healthcare programs that need to be face-to-face, those will be open as well. But again, under pretty strict standard operating procedure. So making sure we're doing some proper social distancing, making sure people are wearing masks, making sure that there's lots of hand washing and sanitation. But I really do want to stress that when we start talking about a virtual campus, or we start talking about upticking the number of classes that we're gonna have in the fall, those trades labs and some science labs as well will be face-to-face, because that's just what we have to do, and that's what's best for the students.
You know, in talking with our university partners, they're predicting a 20% decline in enrollment. That's with Idaho students. And when they look outside of Idaho, international or out of state, it's a 90% reduction is what they're expecting in fall. Those numbers are devastating.
Yes, they are.
And I don't know, we don't see that. We may even see more students in fall. So talk about it. You did briefly, but maybe reiterate on that. So there are students who have been forced off of the university campuses and are sitting likely at home right now. And how do we think about them, and what's our pitch to them for fall?
Come to CEI. Stick with us. So our pitch to them is that we're here for you. And our pitch to them is that we're going to have face-to-face classes for you, but if you're working and you can't come on campus, that we're going to have a whole host of online classes in our virtual campus. So it's interesting, the provost at Boise State, he and I were having a conversation, and he let me know that 7,800 of their students come from out of state, 7,800. And they believe that the majority of those will not come back. And that's probably, I don't know exactly, that's probably about a third of their population. Right. I mean, it's devastating. And so some of those students, we're not out of state, but even some of the students here in Idaho Falls, they're not going to be going back to Boise State. So those ones who don't go back to Boise State, don't go back to University of Idaho, don't go back to Montana State or Utah State, we want them to come here. And if some of them are further along in their program, chances are that they still have one or two or three gen ed courses that they can pick up here. Right. And luckily, we're building a lot of, we have a lot of articulation agreements with most of our partners in the state. And we're even beginning to build some of those articulation agreements outside of the state. We just signed one earlier this week with Western Governors University.
I'm glad you brought that.
Yeah, with Western Governors University, that allows now our students to apply for a scholarship that is only available to partner universities or colleges with Western Governors. That also allows our faculty and staff to apply for those scholarships as well if they want to go to Western Governors. So it's really good. So our message to those students is, we want you here. We want you to come here. We want you to be a part of CEI. Even if we don't offer your program, if you want to be a nuclear engineer, we have math classes that you can take. And if you need your English class, come here and you can take it either face-to-face or online.
So you really have talked through this concept of a virtual campus, and I think we probably need one of these forums with that particular as a topic. But talk for a minute about, or maybe re-elaborate what a virtual campus is to us, because every one of the eight of us do online learning.
Sure.
But a virtual campus is very different than online learning.
Yes. So it is. And we want to make sure that we are making that distinction between what online learning is and what a virtual campus is. And what I would say is, what has happened in the last few weeks, our faculty have just made heroic efforts to move everything online. But really, that's distance learning. And so in summer, we're moving into the online learning. And by fall, we want to be that really full-scale virtual campus. And what a virtual campus means is that along with having really high-quality academic courses where the delivery is very clear and students are really understanding exactly what they need to do in the online learning space, it also encompasses that all of those wraparound services that I've already talked about. So the wraparound services that would come out of Mike's office, which is the advising, the admissions, the counseling, the testing, all of those services, the support services that help get those students through. So I think I've already said this once, but I'll say it again. It is those relationships and the support that really help students persist and graduate. Some of you are tired of hearing this, but I'm going to say it again. So I just started on March 16th, I started a online doctorate program at Arizona State University. And I can tell you the amount of support that I have had since I really from the time that I was admitted, the number of calls and emails and what can we do for you? And have you thought about this resource? And here's something that can help you. And if you're struggling here, here's where you go. So it's all of that that really takes it from just being online classes to a virtual campus. It's support, it's helping students persist and graduate. And that's the direction we wanna go.
When we deal with face-to-face, and you and I have talked about this, we're getting close to capacity when we look at classrooms on this campus. But in some respects, there is a lot more latitude in online because time and place don't matter as much. Now, let's be careful that when we talk about online, there is a use of Zoom in that. And of course, that is synchronous. So place may not matter, but time matters a lot. So talk a little bit about a scaling perspective you might have, because again, I think a lot of our classes need to be those core classes that every freshman and sophomore needs. How do we scale? Do we run out of the ability to offer sections when we talk about online? And why don't we put 200? As a president, I want to see 200 students in a class.
I'm pushing back on that, just so you know. Rick's like, why not? 200 in a class. What's the problem? So no, Rick doesn't really say
that's
that.
That's a joke. I don't say
that. Yeah, he doesn't say that. Oh, Steve Harrison says, no, Rick doesn't really say that. That is a joke.
It is.
So, but the idea would be there are several different ways we could do this. So we talk about template courses, and I've talked with both Ryan and Angela in the last 24 hours about template courses. So there's a course created, say, for History 101. And then as that course, we get 30, 35 students in there. Then we hire another adjunct, and whoever has created that master course, and we kind of pick it up and say, okay, here, adjunct, here is your History 101. So that adjunct doesn't have to go through the whole process of rebuilding another class. So we have these template classes that it becomes very easy to add more and more sections into. So that's one way of doing it. Or not joking, you can just open up a section and have 200 students enroll in it. And then that is one person's load for the semester, just thinking about, you know, is that their five classes? Or then do we start divvying it up with is there a master teacher who then there are adjuncts that are helping to grade and do everything that needs to go on in that class?
And we might say that in a regular lecture class, something like 35.
Yeah.
So it's not that different,
right?
Because we need that interaction with students.
Exactly. So there are different ways to scale, but I think we have a good model in place for us to be able to scale up for the virtual campus.
You know, one of the things that you have done is you've hired a lot of faculty and a lot of student affairs, and talk a little bit about what you think about, because we have an extraordinary group of employees, and a lot of them you hired, and you probably were just lucky, but if that isn't true, what is
it? It was a method to the madness.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
What have you done?
So I just want to say, first of all, we have extraordinary faculty and staff, and that is evidenced by the way we have weathered this crisis. So again, I've talked with people across the state, across the country, even really across the world. I've had the opportunity to talk to a lot of educators, and people are struggling. And I would say, even though it has not been easy for us, we have done it really in an extraordinary way. And part of that is because we have hired well. And so what I would say I look for is certainly people have to have a minimum skill set for whatever they're applying for. But we have had people who have come in with huge amounts of experience and education, and they haven't necessarily been the one who has gotten the job because somebody else who has the cultural fit that you can just tell visiting with them that they get community college, they get our population of students, they get what we're trying to do, which is we are in a completely different position than if you're coming from a community, even a community college that's been established for 50 years. There's so much to be done here. There's a lot of work to be done, but you also get that opportunity to be able to put your stamp on something at the ground floor. So I'm looking for somebody who is really interested in participating in that. They're a fit for our college. We are unique. I don't know that I want to say quirky, but maybe we are quirky. We're amazing. And so we are looking for amazing people, and we have hired amazing people. And that is really evident, again, by the way we have weathered this crisis.
So as a vice president of both academic and student affairs, you get split down the middle. So talk a little bit about how you balance those two, because each of those is very important to a vibrant college. So how do you look at those two functions, and how do you work between them?
Sure. So I start first with the student, and I think that's what student affairs starts with, and that's what academics starts with as well. But both those different areas look at that student in a very different way. So academics looks at a student from, you know, what knowledge will I impart to them? I need to get them certain outcomes for a class, so then those outcomes can roll up and it culminates in a program, which is a degree, certificate, or credential of some sort, making sure that they have certain skills. So on the student affairs side, they are looking at the student experience. What is the student experiencing at college, and how can we improve the student experience? So sometimes those two areas are in tension, but as long as it's a healthy tension, that's really the way it should be. And so I would say that I start with the student, and then I try to balance that healthy tension between the two areas. And right now, we are able to do that because we're not siloed. Again, we're not a 50-year-old institution where student affairs says, this is what I'm supposed to do, and academics says, no, this is what I'm supposed to do with the student, and never the twain shall meet. We have a really great collaboration between the two. Part of that is having amazing deans and staff and faculty on either side who are willing to work together. Again, because our focus on both sides is, how do we make sure that we get that student here, retain them, and get them the credential they need with the best experience possible.
So strangely enough, I still have more questions, you know, and
it's 45 minutes.
Part of this, I get multiple questions, is why don't you let the president talk a little bit? I'm not sure where this. Okay, so in conclusion.
Is that from Mike?
No. So in conclusion, I want you to list three things from a leadership perspective that you've learned during your time here. So as as an executive here and been very successful, give us three tips or three things that you've learned from a leadership perspective.
It's a really good question. The first one is to realize that I don't know everything and I don't have to know everything. And it goes back to this hiring discussion we just had. When you have amazing people who are doing the jobs that they're supposed to be doing, you realize that you don't have to know everything. And so that's really important. You hire good people, you trust them, and you let them do their job. When I first took this job, it was a little scary because it was like, oh my gosh, there's a lot I don't know.
Right.
And certainly there's a learning curve and I'm still learning, but I don't have to learn at all because there's really good people who know that, and I need to let them use their expertise.
So delegation.
Yes, exactly. Okay. So the second one would be that I would say that you have to be flexible and admit your mistakes and know when to pivot and change. And so, Rick, you called it yesterday. What did you call it? Oh, to fail fast. I was just having a conversation with Rick yesterday. So fail fast, figure out what you did wrong, be willing to admit it's wrong, and pivot and go down a different path. Don't be so, you know, don't get too invested in your sunk cost effect. So the final one, and this is really not original with me, it came from some reading I did a couple of weeks ago, but I loved it. And it is that you need to be, as a leader, part poet, part plumber. So a plumber knows how systems work. A plumber knows how to put things together so it works really well. And if there's a problem, if there's a clog somewhere, they know how to get the remove the clog and make things work again. So that's really great if you know how to build systems, if you know how to put things together, if you know how to build a system. But in conjunction with that, you've got to be part poet. You've got to be inspirational. You have to be able to give a vision to all those systems. And if you can put those two together, mm-hmm. I think that you have a leader who can really lead an organization. And a quote from this idea came from a book called On Leadership. And it was James March was a Stanford sociologist for many years. He's passed away now, but he says, every skilled leader is both a poet and a plumber. The poet work of leadership includes articulating direction and formalizing cultural values, crystallizing beliefs with words and stories. The plumbing work of leadership includes the creation of systems and building the discipline of execution. So I think that if you can do both of those and combine both of those, that you can be a really good leader.
Good. So I think that's a wonderful place to end today. So
that's 45 minutes?
Yeah, okay, that's hard to believe.
It is.
So Lori, thank you for that. And we'll do this again next week, and I'll have Byron Miles, Vice President mm-hmm. Miles, come in. We'll talk about maybe a little bit about the finances and a variety of those kind of things that have to do with the college. But thank you for spending some time. And let me also note that we never went over 130. So
thanks, guys.
I'm sorry about that.
But we got close.
We did get close.
So. Yeah, I'll never hear the end of it.
You won't. No, but that's okay.
I'd just like to say thank you all for tuning in. It's been a real pleasure, and you guys are amazing. And thank you.
Absolutely.
No, of course. Thank you, Rick, for having me.
So everyone have a great weekend.
Okay, bye.
Little Sebastian. Oh, look at that.
That's
yes.
Awesome.
Little Sebastian.
We need a little Sebastian.
Yes, we do.
Yeah. All right.
He's adorable.
Yeah. By the way, Parks
bye.
And
bye.
Thank you.
Next Thursday.
Mm-hmm.